Are you struggling to understand the Bible? Is your time in God's Word boring and dry? Join us for Here's Help for Spiritual Growth, where Pastor Chris Aaron Rice and the NLEC team dive deep into God's Word, expounding on all of the wonderful biblical principles God has given us to live by. See radical change in your time with God, as well as in your relationships and in your community, as a watching world sees your faith become evident by what you say and do, you will experience the grace of God to change in marvelous ways. Here's help for spiritual growth.
We are going specifically through three verses today, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 21 through 23. And this ends this incredible prayer that Paul has been praying for the church in Ephesus. So remember, we talked about how all of this is one long sentence and how Paul is combining all of these complex ideas. And last week, we talked about how Paul prayed that they would have the knowledge of three things, right? And that it's this knowledge that will build them up as a church. Paul's goal is always that the church in Ephesus would have a greater idea of who God is and would glorify Him for what He has done in Christ. That's the whole purpose of chapter 1, that they would see those five spiritual blessings and that they would know these three important things so that they would give glory to God for what He has done, right? Now, Paul goes from saying we need to pray for these three things to exalting Jesus Christ for His position as supreme ruler over all things. These verses describe how God the Father has granted Jesus authority over all things in the universe. This is a completed act in the past. When Jesus rose from the grave, that's when God the Father assigned Him authority as ruler over all things. This is done in the past. But then in a sense, it's also going to be done in the future. Does that make sense? Because Paul poses us with a problem here. The problem is that in one sense, the devil still rules, quote unquote, in the world today. We have other scriptures that talk about how he is the prince of the power of this world, how he has dominion over the earth. We live in enemy territory in a very real sense. So what does Paul mean here when he's saying that Jesus has been given power or authority over all things? If Satan still rules here on earth, how does Jesus have power and authority? This is the problem. The answer to this problem is that Jesus rules over all the universe, and yet he allows Satan a long leash. Does that make sense? In a sense, Satan is a defeated enemy already. But that defeat is going to come. And Satan knows this, and that's why he's working so hard to try to divide the church. That's why he's working so hard to promote wickedness and evil and debauchery in the world today. He's doing everything he can to slander the name of Christ, to make him appear as though he does not rule over all things now. And yet we know that just as God has set Christ as king over all the universe, that kingship will flower and bloom in its entirety when Christ returns. Does that make sense? Are you guys following? So, Jesus rules supreme over three different categories here. That's what Paul's talking about. Three different categories in these three verses. okay? The first category that Paul mentions is that Jesus rules supreme over all spiritual authorities. Here we read in verse 21 that God has set Christ far above all rule and authority and power and dominion. And in Greek, the connection here to these things and how they are the spiritual powers, the spiritual rule, the spiritual dominion is much more clear than here in English. But here's what's beautiful about this book. In Ephesians chapter 6, we're going to read this very famous passage about Christians putting on the armor of God. And right after that, or right before that, what does Paul say? He says that our warfare is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the spirits, the power, the dominion, the rule over the air. Listen, Paul is saying that Christ already reigns supreme over all of that, which is what fuels our ability to fight this war. We can fight in the spiritual warfare because Christ reigns supreme. We can fight in hope that we will win because Christ reigns supreme. So Paul's not making any mistake. He's using the exact same language in Ephesians chapter 1 as he does in Ephesians chapter 6 on purpose. So what does it mean to rule? Well, this means that the first or the highest leaders, he's talking about Satan right here when he says that Christ has been set far above all rule or Satan right there. Authority, this refers to the delegated use of power. God in his sovereignty has allowed spiritual powers to rage rampant here on earth. He can do that because he reigns supreme. All power, what does this word refer to? It refers to the inherent ability that a ruler has. The power that comes with the position of rulership. And so, Paul is saying here that Satan again and all of his demons have been given permission to rule, but that Christ rules supreme far above all of them. Dominion refers to the lordship over something. So all of these spiritual forces have been allowed to rule the earth up till now. And the question is, why would God allow Satan to have any dominion, any rule, any authority here on earth? If this is a good God, why would he allow Satan to rule? If Christ already reigns supreme, why would he give them any permission to rule rampant? God is a God of means, right? God is a God of means, meaning that he doesn't create children or powerful children in a snap of a minute. Sometimes we wish that God would just make us perfect right away, right? Have you guys ever wanted to just get rid of this one sin that's clinging to you and you're like, why do I have to continue to struggle against this so hard? Why do I have to work hard to get rid of this one sin? Well, it's because God has given us many means by which to grow, and one of them is actually that God uses Satan's wickedness in a roundabout way to give him greater glory. There's not a single thing that God cannot use or do to redeem his children. So in some sense, the oppression of Satan is used in our lives to give God greater glory and to strengthen us and to cause us to grow in faith as we fight this fight. And if we weren't tested, if we weren't tempted, if we weren't even tried a little bit, how do we know the genuineness of our faith? So God uses even the wickedness of Satan, who's trying to slander his name for his own glory. That's how far above God rules and Christ rules over all spiritual forces. Again, Satan is a defeated enemy. And we know this because Christ has been put far above all rule and authority and power and dominion in the spiritual realms. Here's the point. The point is that God comprehensively puts Jesus over all spiritual forces. God comprehensively puts Jesus above all spiritual forces. There's not a single thing that Satan can do that Jesus is not aware of, and to some extent either allows, gives permission to Satan to do. This is hard for us to wrap our minds around, but the greatest example is to look at Job in the Bible. And here we see this. We see Satan plaguing a specific individual only because God has given him permission to. Satan must submit to the authority of God to do anything to Job. And we ask the question, why on earth would God allow Satan to do that? Well, God receives greater glory when his children are tested and tried and come out on the other end with faith. Does that make sense? But the point here in this passage that Paul's trying to relate is that Jesus Christ has been comprehensively put above all spiritual forces in heaven. The second category is that Jesus reigns as supreme over all names. Verse 22 says that, it's actually still in verse 21. And above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. So in Greek and in Hebrew, back in the ancient world in general, a name held a whole lot more meaning than it does today. When I say Bill Maddock, it is a sound that I make so that when I say his name, he responds, right? But in the ancient world, a name would be directly connected to the character of that person. It would be directly connected to the character of that person. So when a name changes in the Bible, you should take note of it, because it is saying that the fundamental character of that person is changing. Okay? The only difference to this general principle and rule is that there are lots of names that we have for God, and it's not as though God's character changes, but in revealing more of himself, he just shows another part of his character by revealing a different name. But when Abram goes from Abram to Abraham, that is a significant name change. And so studying Hebrew names and what they mean can give you insight into what's actually going on, right? One example, Naomi. Naomi means pleasantness, okay? But when Naomi has her husband die and both of her sons, and she becomes a widow, and she goes back to Bethlehem, she says, my name is no longer Naomi. Don't call me that. Call me Mara, which means bitter. Why does she want her name to be changed? Because her character has gone to one of bitterness. She perceives God as afflicting her and causing her to be bitter. She was resentful and angry at God for what had happened to her. And you know what's funny is that in that short book, the Bible doesn't change her name from Naomi. She says, call me Mara, bitterness. But throughout the whole rest of the book, and towards the end, she resolves her problems with God. Okay, just making note. But generally, after a name has been changed, the Bible will use that name going forward. When Saul's name gets changed to Paul, he's known as Paul through the rest of those books. When Naomi said, "My name is Mara," it still uses Naomi through the rest of that short book. And by the end, she comes to glorify God again for his provision through Ruth and Boaz. Okay? So, all of that to say, names have meaning, and when the Bible says here that Jesus Christ is being put above all names, he's saying that the character and the person and the work of Jesus Christ, what that name implies, is above all other names in history. Can you think of some great men and women in your life who you think deserve honor and praise? Christ's name is above that name. We can think of great people in history who deserve by their works to be praised, and yet Christ's name is above that name. Here's one application that I want you to understand and be careful of. Listen, be careful how you use the name Jesus. If you use it flippantly, you are slandering his great name. We should be humble in our approach to even mentioning our Savior. And when we do it, we should do it with such reverence and awe at his character. And by doing that, we give him the glory that he is due. You know, in one sense, the third commandment in the Ten Commandments is what? Does anybody know? Do not use the Lord's name in vain. You know what's beautiful about this? He's told you more about who that Lord is. You got a person that you can put to that name. And you know a lot about that person. How do you know a lot about that person? Because God's word tells you so much about the character and the work of Jesus Christ. You want to know who Jesus is? Read the Gospels. You want to know who he is? Read Acts. You want to know the person, the character of the Savior? Read his word. He has set this name above all names. There is not a name in history that will be even close to comparison to the mighty character and work and power of Jesus Christ. Not only now, but for all eternity. Jesus demands, deserves respect. And there is incredible power in the name of Jesus. We should be careful not to slander him by stubbing our toe and crying out in profanity, right? Or being flippant when we talk about our great and mighty Savior. Acts chapter 4, verse 12 says, "And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Do you hear that? There's no other name under heaven by which you must be saved other than Jesus Christ. That's the incredible power of his name. He saves you from your sin. And there is no other name that can do that. Nietzsche doesn't even come close. Kant can't be compared. Buddha is a fat green statue there that sits on the wall, right? Hinduism, well, by God, there's like 30,000 gods, and none of them can save you. There is one name by which you must be saved, and his name is Jesus. By the way, Christ is not Jesus' last name. I don't know if you knew that, okay? Christ is not Jesus' last name. It is a title that simply means the anointed one. Christ comes from Christos in Greek, which is the equivalent of Messiah in Hebrew. Okay? Messiah means the anointed one. Jesus is God the Father's anointed Savior for the world. Okay? The third category is that Jesus reigns supreme over all things. So he gets to this point where he just exalts Christ, says, and God the Father put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Like a conquering king, Jesus Christ places his foot on the neck of Satan. Like a conquering king, Jesus puts his foot on the neck of Satan. This is the accumulation of the prophecy that God made in Genesis chapter 3, all the way back then. Okay? After the fall of man, God says that he will make a seed of the woman step on the head of the snake, and that snake will bite his heel. Right? Talking about the incredible death, but resurrection of Christ. So the prophecy in Genesis 3, Paul is saying, has been fulfilled. That Christ would conquer Satan and have his foot on the neck of the snake. Praise the Lord. The church comes from the Greek word ecclesia, which literally means the called out ones. The church are the called out ones of God. God calls or summons his children to him. Remember, we talked about this several weeks ago. Do you guys remember that? Earlier in this chapter, he talks about being chosen in Christ, how we are called in him, this summoning that God does. That's the church. The church is not a country club. The church isn't a special, you know, group of people that you just go to once a week and hang out with. That's not what the church should be. This is the called out ones of God. And he's talking about the invisible church, the body of Christ, the union that those who are in this room who are regenerate and born again, the union that you have with someone in Africa or China or the Middle East as a called out one of God. And let me tell you, there is so much joy that comes from fellowship with other believers. There's so much joy that comes from genuine fellowship with other believers. Why? Because we both have the same head. We both have the same king. All the other differences that would naturally separate us from fellowship are all gone. Because the one thing that lasts is that the ruler of that person and the ruler of me are the same. Does that make sense? Have you ever considered the fact that as a called out body of believers, the fact that Christ rules as head separates all other different differences that we might have? See, the church can be described in two different realities here in Scripture. It can mean the invisible body of Christ, which is what is being meant here in context. But it also could mean the local assembly of believers. So when you and I gather like we are in this room today, we are obeying Scripture in multiple different ways right now. But then there's this other higher reality of the invisible church that will always prevail. Satan cannot stomp out the true and invisible church of God. He can't do it. Why? Because Christ reigns supreme. So listen, all of you have been burned by church. I have too. So all of you have seen churches get ruined by sex scandals or ruined by abuse from the top down. All the people who've seen in the news about these horrible abuses of authority, you could get downcast and say, if this is the church, Jesus doesn't rule over anything and he's failed, right? let me assure you, let me give you the incredible hope that though you can't see the invisible body of believers the way that God sees them, there is no way that Satan can conquer the church. There is no way that his plan in calling out True Assembly could fail. Because Christ reigns supreme over all things. And he has set him as the head of the church. And the church is the body of Christ who rules all in all. He fills all in all. So Jesus is the head of his body, and he cannot fail to complete his work in all his children. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that incredible? That though you may see the brokenness of the world today, you may see how people are constantly failing to look like Christ within the assembly. You may be hurt and burned by people who are not living according to what the Bible says. And yet God reigns supreme over the real, true, invisible body of Christ. And that body continues to grow without you knowing. There are places in the world right now where the church is thriving. Thriving. Under incredible persecution, which historically, by the way, is how the church spreads and grows. I've been recently contemplating and thinking about this one statement, and we'll leave with this. What can your faith survive? What can your faith survive? Listen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, all of us go through trials and hardships. All of us experience the brokenness of our own personal sin, being sinned against. All of us have been sick. All of us have broken, well, not all of us have broken bones, but all of us have gotten injured in some way, cut, bruised, battered, externally and internally. But we must question, what is it that our faith can survive? Because a true saving faith, one that regenerates your heart, can survive all things. Even if you have a Job-like experience, even if your family and your wealth and your health and your prosperity and everything gets wiped off the face of the earth, you can still survive with faith in God. And listen, I believe that we're coming to a point in which the true church will be exposed. I believe we're coming to a point where we must know Christ and live as though that knowledge is changing our lives for His glory. We must prepare by getting ready to give a defense for our hope in Christ. And we can do that by reading His Word, by praying, by enjoying fellowship with true believers, and by preparing for the work that He is going to give us when we are tested and tried. What can your faith survive? Is your faith in the supreme ruler over all things? Or is your faith more in yourself? And will you fall away when hard times come? That's true faith, is one that can survive all things. Thank you.
Thank you so much for watching Here's Help for Spiritual Growth. Our prayer here at New Life is that you have been built in your faith as we faithfully apply biblical principles into our world today. The world is watching, and the church no longer has the excuse to stand by the wayside and watch the world grow in wickedness and evil. We must speak the truth in love by knowing the truth first and living out the truth in our lives and our relationships. May the Lord bless you and keep you as you go and journey through God's Word in faithfulness.